Deepwater Horizon. Oh, we about to get serious. I know we've been having fun tonight, but this is a serious right here. People lost their lives in this. It's a movie about a rig off the Gulf of Mexico, and this happened on April 20th of 2010. One of the biggest oil spills in history, done by BP,
British Petroleum.
And this is the story about the rig that went down during that oil spill and some of the people that died and some of the heroic people that helped keep people from dying. Mainly Mike Williams, who was played by Mark Wahlberg in this. And one of the things that I really like about this movie is that it captures a realness at the beginning. It's almost like if this was directed by, now you guys know Paul Greengrass. Mm-hmm. You know, he does all the Bourne movies. Like, you know, he can't put a camera on a tripod ever.
No.
You know,
get the goddamn tripod off my set.
Even Captain Phillips was like, shit, like, dude, chill.
Yeah, he can't, don't bring a tripod to the set. He'll stab you with that shit, stick it right up your ass. Have you walking like Corey Feldman? You know, it's but one of the times that I saw him do another disaster movie, also based on a live event, was United 93. And one of the things I really enjoyed about United 93 is that they used a lot of people, even some people who were actually involved in the, that's from 9/11. United 93 is one of the planes that hit one of the Twin Towers during 9/11. And one of the powerful things about that movie is that they use what seemed like a lot of real people. I think even some people who were working at the airport at that time were involved in this. And so he kind of does the same thing here. This is almost like if this was a movie.
Paul Greengrass?
Yeah, I think.
I thought this was Peter Berg.
No, I'm not talking. I said Martin. Listen, I said it feels like a movie as if it was directed.
Sorry.
Martin's okay. Tuning out. He's like, wait a minute, what you say? No, give me time, brother. I know what I'm doing. I've been doing this a long time.
Taking us through a labyrinth. I got a little lost.
No, yeah, you did. Hey, go get him, Corey.
I'm going to get lost, too. drop some breadcrumbs next time.
Yeah, pull some string or something. Put the entire piece of yarn to you. Pulling them little boy leashes on you. But this is if you took Paul Greengrass and Michael Bay and had them direct a movie together, that seems like what you got right here.
That sums up Peter Berg pretty well, yeah, on everything.
Yeah, Peter Berg has done this before, too, in some movies. You know, Peter. I would say that, you know, the elements that Peter Berg is taken from these two is that he has Paul Greengrass's sensitivities when it comes to directing actors, especially with some of the actors that are there that seem like either real people that they've used or speaking extras that you don't know, and, you know, are not, you know, doing the type of acting that we see very transparent from professional actors. And then when the shit kicks in, you know,
he goes all Michael Bay,
complete with a lot of things that you see as Michael Bay's trademark. And when the thing that makes the people seem real is that the dialogue among the workers, man, they seem like real blue collar people that are working on this rig together. They have the same banter that people who work together have, and that one of the things that helps with is that when you see these people as real people, man, they're cool. They're like, hey, man, I work with that dude. Oh, he's just blue collar like me, man. You know that guy worked that, especially Mark Wahlberg. You know that guy worked that can just go in and you mad on Mondays. You don't want to be there, but they got that one guy who can come around and be happy and just make everybody feel good. Hey, you see the game yesterday? What's going on, man? What's up? You know, all these people are like that, and they're cool. So you don't want any of them to die. It's like the stakes are high. You really hurt knowing what's about to happen because all these people are people that you like. You don't know them for long, but you're like, man, they're all decent. They're all kind of, and they're all kind of funny and charming in their own way. Everybody's singing disco songs and shit when they're going through that money. You mean I said money, yeah, money.
Right.
Money. You know, these people are
all like the OJs. They're like me.
Yeah, and then that's what I'm talking about. Like, these people singing disco songs and Mark Wahlberg comes back. He's about to leave, like, hey, give me one more money. Money. You're like, oh man, I can't watch these people die.
What's the song at the beginning of Armageddon?
No, I know it sounds like that, but it's not, man.
Oh, okay.
And all the dialogue sounds very natural. Doesn't sound overly scripted or even scripted at all. And when it does, it's delivered by people who know how to talk shit. What's his name?
Kurt Russell.
Kurt Russell, who's running this rig right here, plays a real-life guy, Jimmy Harrell.
Mr. Jimmy.
Mr. Jimmy is what they call him. He look like a Mr. Jimmy, too. You know, in other words, he's like an old motherfucker, you know. The oldest dude on the rig. Hey, only one they call Mr. Mr. Old ass Mr. Jimmy. Yeah, old ass Mr. Jimmy, whoop your ass till you keep fucking with him. You look just like Kurt Russell. But then they... But you also have Mark Wahlberg. And Mark Wahlberg... This is one of the best roles he's had in a long time, man, if you ask me. I know maybe you disagree with me, but...
Well, yeah, and as much as he's been having some kind of fucked up roles for lately, so yeah, this is one of the best.
But when you give him something... Look, Mark Wahlberg, he can play blue collar.
Sure. Don't make him a college professor.
No, don't.
Or an astronaut.
No, don't make him an astronaut and send him to the planet of the apes. Shit, them apes be smarter than he is, you know?
He basically just said, don't give him a job with a college degree you would need.
No. No, Mark Wahlberg, as far as characters go, he just got his GED. You know,
he's very believable in Ted.
Yeah, exactly. Talking to a stoner, talking to a teddy bear.
Yeah, pain and gain.
Had that motherfucker drive a bus or something. I can deal with that. And in this... But the thing about it is, as I said, he can talk shit like nobody else. And if you put him in a movie where he needs to do that, and you give him the right lines, he can pull that shit off, not only with a lot of charm, but with authority, too. One of the BP guys, played by John Malkovich, one of the head guys, tries to talk shit to him. He's like, hey, man, you don't know nothing about me. You don't know nothing about this rig. I've been on this rig for months now, and I know more about it than you ever will.
Name a few for me.
A few? Telephone system, pipe rack system, GPS antenna, direct TV system, wireless internet, iron roofneck, top drive rack back system, auxiliary draw works control, salt water service pump, smoke alarms in the galley. The reason why you're sweating so hard is because the compressor with the AC on this deck are down too.
Who are you?
I'm Batman, bitch. And you looking like the Joker right now.
Boy, I said name one.
Look at him. Shit, he's dumbfounded right now. He's lost. At this point, he's daydreaming. You're like Deadpool. I'll leave the oven on right now. You know, and that's the thing about John Malkovich in the movie, too, is that everybody's playing it so real. He's the one. I wish they had actually been able to not make the villains villainous. He's a BP guy. He's one of the guys who's the higher-ups. He's one of the executives. He comes down, of course. He doesn't know anything about these blue-collar guys that are sweating and bleeding for this job. And you could tell – I mean, first of all, it's John Malkovich, so you know he's a villain. But at the same time, they give him this really slimy Cajun accent. You know, he goes through. It's just
– he struggles to hold on to. But
but the whole time
– I mean, it goes from being like, oh, that's a good Cajun accent, to him playing a cartoon character that might as well be a giant crawfish.
Yeah, he's so he's going through, and I mean he's talking like that real heavy Cajun. I know this man and talk like that. You know he's going there, telling me that how this hair rig work. How
I know some cayenne pepper on now.
Yeah, there's points where people try to defy him, and he's telling them like, well, see, huh, ain't gonna be my fault when I tell them up there what you told me right here. You know, like, come, damn, he should just be boiling lobsters and crawfish while he's talking and shit.
That should be,
it's gumbo, yeah. And he's so slimy when he does it too. It's like there was a moment you just saw a snake tongue come out of his mouth when he was speaking down to these people.
New Voldemort.
Yeah,
Cajun
man.
Voldemort.
I say it out there, pot of salt. It's with everybody being real in the movie, his role really stands out, and it really draws attention to itself, but it doesn't matter, because at some point, now the thing is, when this movie is going, you can let little things slide, you can let John Malkovich slide, and you can, and when you, but when these other people are so cool and you don't want them to die, you're watching this movie and it's almost like that, you know, that sickening feeling, that heavy sinking anticipation you get when you about to take that first dip on that roller coaster.
Uh-huh.
And that's why you feel here, knowing that these people are in for a terrible fate or a terrible experience. But then you tell yourself, God damn it, I came in here to see some explosions and I'm going to get them.
Well, that's the thing. You got Mark Wahlberg and Kurt Russell and John Malkovich and Ethan Suplee and a bunch of other people. But they aren't the star of this movie.
No.
Stardust movie.
It's fire.
Right there.
Yeah.
That explosion right there.
Explosions. I mean, you, as much as you care about this people, you say, if one of these motherfuckers don't blow up,
I'm just spontaneously combust.
If somebody ain't don't die by getting set on fire or drowning in mud, I'm going to set this theater on fire. You want to see somebody die.
You want everybody to live, But after a while, when you don't see nobody die, you like, yeah, somebody gotta get blown up.
Bloodthirsty in this movie.
I'm sorry, man. That's the way it works. That's the way it works. You sitting up there so long. Okay, y'all cool, fine, cool. Somebody got to die now.
Oh shit. Okay, he got blown up. Oh, he's getting back up, motherfucker.
Yeah. We turned some gladiator shit, man. You know, we were blood. We wanted blood, man. Burning flesh. Shit, we want to eat people watching this movie, man.
And people get fucked up in this movie.
And they do.
Especially Kurt Russell.
When this movie, when explosions happen, they just don't, I mean, we don't just have explosions. We have fire that just picks people up like bounces and just throws them up against the wall.
It's like that fire tornado in that Twister movie.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it's not like something like Commando where the explosion goes off and it just kind of gently pops you up in the air and you land and roll a little bit.
No, it
slams you into glass, into solid walls.
It was like
walls.
You said something to make that fire, man. Right. It picked you up by your pants and threw your ass right into a wall. You, Wahlberg. Yeah, you think you tough?
They found that little itty bitty stairwell in that entire room to throw his ass down.
Yeah, hell yeah, and that's what makes it good. I love that shit. Don't give a fuck. You from the streets of New York? You know it's and what's who's that playing his wife in the movie?
Kate Hudson.
Kate Hudson, man. It's you know it. Look, when this stuff happens, you have the reactions of the relatives that are making this bad. But it's the explosions that go on. And I love the cinematography in this, because when it starts out, I mean, it almost feels like, I said, everything is handheld. It feels like it's almost like a low budget kind of handheld too, which helps again because it makes everything feel like it's real. But when that's a setup to catch you off. When hell breaks loose, and I mean hell, when the gates of hell opens up in this, everything just turns into an angry, fiery orange and red. You know, half the time you can't even see what's happening because there are moments where it just turns to black, and it gets you all disoriented. The rig itself, I mean, there's nowhere to run that's not narrow. There's nowhere to run that you can't get a compartment where you can't get stuck and burn alive or drown or get pierced by debris.
Well, also, like, when you think, like, we're in the water, I'm going to just jump in the water, and you look, and the water's on fire.
The water's on fire. And the only way to go, the only place to go is high. So that patch of water right there that you have to jump into, that might kill you, too. Mm-hmm. The movie plays very well on claustrophobia. And, you know, before they even lead up to that, or before they even get to the fire, the lead up to it is actually really cool. I mean, it's a great balance of a lot of things because they have horror elements that they introduce. I mean, mud ain't never been so intimidating as it has been in this movie. Mud just creeps onto the scene like a movie monster,
like the
blob or something. Yeah, I mean, because when you see mud popping up, that's pretty much mud saying that's your ass. Yeah, you fucked up. You know, you're trying to like, what's that? You know what the fuck that is. You know, it's and the reason why this went down is because you had executives and people who were doing the oversight and the higher ups, like John Malkovich's character right here, who just wanted to save money and didn't go in and fully do the proper inspections. Mm-hmm. If they had, they would have seen that some of the concrete was weak, and they wouldn't have proceeded with drilling. Mm-hmm. And you know, they even tried to pull some of the tests and fool themselves. But yeah, this whole thing didn't have to happen. Even show you some of the wildlife that was dying in this. You know, they try to remind you about everything, the biggest tragedy that happened with this. You know, I think for this movie to be as good as it is, it's very obvious in some areas too. I mean, they know the right crowd that they're appealing to.
Sure.
It's because when I went, I don't mean, look, I'm not trying to be mean, I'm not trying to be rude, but when I walked in, I said, damn, there's a lot of old white people in here.
You know what I mean? The silly crowd.
Yeah, it was. It was, yeah, there's a lot of people that look like Clint Eastwood, mm-hmm. You know, even the women. You know, but, and I watched the movie and I said, they are marketing towards a certain demographic. They are marketing towards that white, conservative, older, very, very mature demographic. And you could tell with the movie, because one of the things that you see in Michael Bay movies, that flag That there was so many times.
That's right. It was unnecessarily there.
Did you notice that?
Like, yeah, I did.
Like, that's what I was even showing you everything, but there were moments where that flag is for all these people that were in danger. That flag just came up. Hey, look at me, you know. And that flag didn't burn either. If you notice,
I did notice that.
Like flames tried to even touch the flag, and they were like
oh, that's the American flag. Wait, can't touch that.
sorry. You know, they're doing this because of the controversy about patriotism and whatnot. I can guarantee you that. But does that take away from the movie? No, it doesn't. As far as a disaster movie goes, this is one of the most thrilling things that you will see. And when you watch the end of the film, they do a very emotional and heartfelt moment for the people that did die on the rig. And Mark Wahlberg, as I said, man, one of the reasons why I'm saying that this is one of his best performances is because there's a moment where he breaks down after this whole thing happens. You feel the disorientation when he goes in, the PTSD after it just happens. You feel the none of this is worded. None of this is scripted. None of this is said by the or spoken by the characters. But you can feel the survivor's guilt going on with him.
You know what? You're right. He does have that moment, and it's good for him. But it didn't hit me near as much as Captain Phillips, when Tom Hanks has that moment, Captain Phillips.
Really? Because I was moved by that. I didn't cry because, you know, I ain't no bitch. But, you know.
Jurassic Park.
You are, but you just didn't cry.
Yeah, but for this. Now, you make Mark Wahlberg a brontosaurus, I'll cry for that shit. roar, bro. Roar.
I'm a meteor. I'm a painter.
But I kind of teared up, man. I was like, wow, I'm really moved by this. And I even heard people behind me. They were crying during that part. And I just like it because I'd like a director who can come in and let the scene speak for itself. None of that. There's very, very few words at the end of this movie. And I thought that was more moving than anything that they could have put into words. And especially showing the images of the real people at the end of the film. So, you know,
it's a funny thing coming out of this, because I know there are people who like watched it and got emotional, especially angry at John Malkovich's character, the BP guy. He's like, oh, those assholes, British Petroleum, if they just trying to cut corners and do this. And the thing is, I came out of it looking at it, like the way it plays out. I was like, you know what? That guy's not as evil as they want to paint him out to be, because the way the test looked, you know, it could have gone either way.
Warning him, though, you know.
Yeah, but even they said, like, well, looking like that, man, maybe you're right. It's just like he was pushing towards one way, but they even agreed, like, yeah, it's not doing this thing we said it was going to do.
Now, you see what you just said there? Had they actually had that for his character in the movie where they didn't play him up like,
oh, I know. I know. That would have made it better. I think they unintentionally showed both sides. I think they should have, you know, really gone all the way and invested in showing, hey, this was purely an accident. Yeah, they thought they were overly cautious. We weren't cautious enough, but we both were kind of seeing the same things. Anybody could have made this mistake.
Yeah.
Yeah. So much of what's good about this movie is what it doesn't do wrong, and what we've seen over and over so often with the disaster movies. It's all about the disaster. You don't have a chance to care about the characters. And here you do. They show you a bunch of them before going in. And I wouldn't say it's great what they show you before, but it's enough, because they aren't really the stars of the movie.
Yeah.
And it does a good job. I mean, you so nailed it, saying he's Paul Greengrass one minute and Michael Bay the next. But it's almost like, man, I wish Peter Berg could just take over most of Michael Bay's movies, because he knows what to put in and when to pull back. And it's entertaining, especially if you're interested in this. It plays it out well, and it's great in its understatement. I liked it, but I didn't love it. I found it not all that memorable. You know, like, I didn't get emotional about it.
You, sir, are not American. How dare you disrespect these people who gave their lives for oil? How dare you, sir?
Hey, no. I love the fact that they paid tribute to these people. They found actors who were about 50 pounds lighter than each one of those people that they show at the end. It's funny when they show the real people at the end, like all of them.
Boy, it is almost an insult what they do to the people. The real people, the real Mike Williams and his wife. They might as Hollywood might as well looked at them and said, you know what, y'all will not sell tickets.
Yeah.
You know, because if we had to cast y'all like y'all really look, we'd have to cast Louis C.K. and as your wife, we had to get Melissa McCarthy. And this is not a comedy. You know, it was almost like they Hollywood just told him, no, y'all look like shit.
And every time they show one of the people who died, you're like, and this is the guy's story, and you're like, yeah. Man, so they all just ate at gyms right before they would go to work
and
every day.
And it's funny now that these guys are, you know, they made this movie and everything. Now my man, was it Mike Williams? He's trying to get Hollywood now. He's looking like Duck Dynasty. Look at this. Look. Before that, he got his acne cleared up and everything. Look at this, man. Shit, he's like, I'm hanging out with Mark Wahlberg. Meanwhile, you know Mark Wahlberg, like, who? Mike, who?
Who are you again?
Oh, yeah, that oil movie. Yeah, bro. Boy, you hit it right there, man. But go ahead. I'm sorry.
Honestly, it falls in that category of movies I don't have a lot to say about. If you want to see it, you should. It works better than you think it might. Because when we first saw the trailer for this, I was thinking it was going to be something a lot more bombastic or another Mark Wahlberg.
Or like that movie, The Finest Hours, that we just saw. Oh,
yes, yeah, yes, 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 yes. And it's not terribly dissimilar, but it is much better than that.
Okay.
But it's not one where I go like, well, like I said, I didn't have an emotional reaction to it, so it's hard for me to tell people to run out and see it. But just for how well it's made, I would give it a matinee.
A matinee. All right. Well, I, being a true patriot and somebody that respects human life and value, I give this a full price.
Okay.
You know, I'm just messing with you. But I was moved by Wahlberg, man.
I get it.
You know, I thought this captured everything that is missing from a lot of action films and disaster movies. Emotion and good direction. There's a lot of things here that they were able to do where they just let these characters speak for themselves.
In a small amount of time, actually.
Yeah.
And Kurt Russell's really good in it.
Yeah, and Kurt, why don't you, for Kurt, man, full price, man. Come on.
Is it Kurt Russell or Jeff Bridges? When you look, you can't really tell.
Well, I know. I want them in the same movie with dueling mustaches.
No, that'll be the Tron sequel, Clue and the
Hey, man. Hey, do it for Mr. Jimmy, man. Come on. Hey, Mr. Jimmy gonna whoop your ass. Hey? Keep fucking with movies. Where's Martin at? Y'all got the same mustache, man. Come on. Just about.
I know. Here's a little bit more Yosemite Sam than mine.
It is. Who's that varmint that gave me a matinee?
Him and Creole John Malkovich.
John Malkovich. Jesus. Him and Creole John Malkovich. I'll say that. Who the hell get my movie a matinee now? So tell me why. What's your name, boy? Gamefly brings to your house, to you, over 8,000 new releases and classics that are available to rent, or you can buy them for almost every system out there, current and some old systems. Like I said, man, I've been trying to put my GameCube back to work for years. Gamefly has given me an excuse to do that, and you can even try 30 days for free by typing in gameflyoffer.com/doubletoasted. And when you do that, you'll get 30 days for free of games and movies. Get all those things, all of them at once. Just stay in the house. Don't go nowhere, because they're all going to get brought right to your mailbox. You can also bring the element of surprise every month to your home in the form of a loot crate mystery box. In that box, I can't tell you what it is, but I can guarantee you it is the best in geek and gaming gear. Some people say it's like having Comic-Con brought right to your home. You don't have to leave the house for nothing. You're getting all kind of stuff. And everybody likes a little surprise every month. Just a little bit. And here's another surprise for you. You know, if you go to our link, trylootcrate.com/doubletoasted, and you type in bridge 10, that's the word bridge, and the number 10, you can get 10% off, a 10% discount on your first crate. How's that for a surprise right there? Loot Crate, bring the mystery and the surprise to your mailbox once a month with Loot Crate. Hey everyone, thanks for watching, and be sure to subscribe to our channel and go over to our home, doubletoasted.com, for more videos and live streams. And remember, stay toasty.